Hi, and welcome to Lisa's Stamp Studio and tonight's YouTube Live. My name is Lisa Curcio. I am so excited that you're here with me. If you are here watching the replay, please leave comments below. I come back and read every single one and do reply to you. I'm excited to share tonight's background with you. Super easy, and it's going to incorporate a technique as well. Now, this is not just a great project for cards. It's going to be great for all your paper crafting. And as always, I've got lots of tips to share with you tonight. I've got a beautiful color palette, but keep in mind, you can change this up to look however you'd like. And you're going to be able to use a wide variety of different stamps. Now, for those of you that are joining me live, special hello to you. Thank you for being here with me. If you would like to chat, make sure that you log into your YouTube account, which is your Gmail address that will allow you to chat. And before you get started, I want to make sure that you know who Megan is. Megan's name is in blue here during the YouTube Live, and she is my assistant. And while my head is down at the stamp table, very busy stamping, I can't get to all your questions or your comments. So Megan's here to help interact with you and keep you abreast of what's going on and certainly be able to answer those questions I don't get to. I am super excited about tonight. What do you guys say we get started? Okay, let me turn the camera down and then we'll get you all zoomed in and ready to go. Okay, here we go. And give me just a second to get you zoomed in, and I want to get this centered so that it's in your best view possible. I think we're pretty good. I might move you in. Well, I'm going to leave you there. I was going to move you in a little closer, but I decided not to. We are going to start with the very basic step tonight, and that's going to be with the stamping, because we're going to do the first technique before we do the next technique. This is just regular whisper white cardstock. I have cut it down to the cardstock size I need for my project, but please keep in mind, if you are more comfortable cutting this bigger to work with and then trimming it down when you're all finished, then that's completely fine. You're going to want to do what's easiest for your hand. I am going to be using this absolutely stunning background stamp, and this stamp set is called Breathtaking Bouquet. And if you're looking for it, it's going to be in the brand new Stampin' Up! Mini catalog. I don't know much longer I can say it's brand new, but it is new. Just started here in January. Absolutely breathtaking. That's why it's called that. Now, you might look at this and think, oh my gosh, I don't want to color that. And that's what's great about tonight's live, is because I'm going to share a technique with you that's going to skip the step of coloring in all these details. But I also want to give you a little teaser that in 2 days from now, I'm going to have another video using this exact same background to give you another idea. So make sure you subscribe to my channel if you haven't done that yet. Now, you can see how large this is, especially in conjunction to my cardstock. I suffer with some basal joint arthritis, and any of you that have arthritis know how painful that can be. So manhandling these large stamps is very difficult for me. So I want to show you what I do, and hopefully it's going to help one of you as well. I'm going to be doing some heat embossing. So I've got my heat tool nearby, and I always make sure before I get inking that I also have my coffee filter with my embossing powder. And tonight I'm going to be using white. I love to use the coffee filter so that I'm able to pinch it and pour the excess right back into the bottle so that there's virtually no waste. The very first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to prep the surface before I heat emboss. And this is the embossing buddy. There's an anti-static powder inside of here that actually will tell the embossing powder not to stick where there is an ink. Now, this is especially helpful for detailed stamps such as this one, and greetings. I don't know about you, but those little flecks, especially on dark cardstock, are really distracting. And that little embossing buddy works like a charm. I'm going to be using my Versamark. This is a watermark ink pad. Now, you can also use this as regular ink on dark colored cardstock, and it'll leave you a beautiful tone-on-tone watermark appearance for backgrounds. But I'm going to use it for heat embossing. I'm going to go ahead and just tap that right on top of my stamp. Now, I am going to cover this area carefully because I know it's detailed, and I'm going to try really hard not to miss an area, especially because you're watching me. So I'm going to go over it several times. You don't want to push this pad so it's squishy inside the stamp, okay? It's spongy. It's not like the other ink pads. So I'm going to turn my cap upside down this way so I can just recap this. And because my hands are always sore from the arthritis, I'm going to leave this face up on my work surface, and I'm going to take my cardstock that's been prepped face down right on top of here. I'm using my large grid paper, and I'm folding that right over the top to protect the ink from my hands. And then what I'm going to do with a flat hand is I'm going to rub. Now, if you work better with the heel of your hand or the palm of your hand, by all means, you can do that. But what's happening is I'm actually transferring the design from the bottom up, which is going to make this a whole lot easier than trying to hold that really wide stamp. So I'm just making sure that I've got really good coverage, and I think I'm in pretty good shape. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to use my paper piercing tool with the attachment, and I am very carefully going to lift this off. I'm going to throw that right off camera. And this is where I'm going to come in now with my embossing powder. Now, I know you probably cannot see this, but here we go. We are going to pour powder very generously over this, which is why I like to use my coffee filter. Can you start to see it come to life? And then I'm going to turn and I'm going to pinch it by the corner and I'm going to do the other side. Oftentimes I hear, oh, I love background stamps, but I'm really afraid to use them because they're so big. Don't be afraid. It's okay. That's why I suggested that if you feel more comfortable having a background stamp being used with a larger piece of cardstock, by all means do that, because then you're able to manhandle the edges a little bit more and make it easier for you. I'm going to zoom you in just a little bit. I'm going to try to get you all inside of here. Now, the heat tool is fantastic. The one with Stampin' Up! Is really my favorite. There are two speeds. So speed one is great if you're trying to dry cardstock, if you enjoy doing mediums. Maybe you're into watercoloring or mixed media. Two is to actually heat emboss or set the powder on the highest speed possible. You're going to see that the nozzle is encased, which is going to help to retain the heat of the tool. So that if you're doing multiples of these, it's going to go faster and faster each time. Now, I'm not going to do the whole thing because I know this is going to be kind of loud. I've got one that's already finished for the next step, but I do want to talk you through this because a lot of you tell me that you're new to heat embossing and it somewhat intimidates you, and there's no reason to. So I'm going to turn it on. It's going to need a little time to get warm, under a minute, really. I'm going to recommend that you start in one spot at a time. Oftentimes when people heat emboss, they like to go everywhere, and I don't ever recommend that because especially with white on white, it's going to make it virtually impossible to see where you left off. So I'm also going to recommend that you get your head way down by the table so that you can see that that white powder turns to a foily, if it's silver, or in this case, an enamel shiny finish. Work close to the paper. Keep the gun moving. Yes, you can burn it, which means you can actually scorch it, turn it like a light yellow or even a brown color. As the paper and the powder conducts the heat, it will actually spread faster. And like I said, the beauty of this is that you're able to do one embossed project after another because the gun's going to retain the heat. So you're going to see now at the top, I'm going to hold this up to make it a little bit easier for you. Let me turn that off because I know that sound can be quite distracting for any period of time. Do you see the difference here between the powder and the heat embossing? Okay, I've got one that's already finished. I'm going to set this one aside. I'll finish that a little bit later. One thing I do want to mention, once you ink that, you have to powder it immediately because if that ink dries, that powder will not stick to it. And it's also very important that you check your project when you're done. You want to make sure that you don't have an area that's missed being heat set, because if you do, what's going to happen is when you touch it, the powder is going to rub right off, which is going to do no help whatsoever for this next step. Now, keep in mind, embossing powders come in a myriad of colors, absolutely beautiful. Gold, silver, copper, white, clear. I mean, you can just have a field day. All these products are in my online store at lisastampstudio.com. Now, if you've ever heat embossed before, you're going to notice your work surface is really gritty. And I want to give you a great cleanup tip. This is half of a Swiffer sheet. So those things you put on your little Swiffer mops and you dust up the floors. I cut these in half and I leave them here in the studio so that I can go over my work surface and it's going to pick up every little fleck, or just about every little fleck of the leftover embossing powder. Because even though you use the heat tool, some of it does blow. And you certainly don't want that to transfer to your ink pads because that's what we're going to be doing next, because that would leave little specks in there and that's not good. All right, so here we go. We've got our image. The next thing I'm going to do is we are going to add some color, and I'm going to be using Highland Heather. I'm going to open that up. I'm going to get that all ready. I'm going to put this off to the side. Now I'm going to zoom you out just a little bit because I want to make sure that you're going to be able to see well. I am going to be using a sponge brayer for this next technique. Now, if you are more comfortable using a sponge dauber or even a sponge, that is fine. Any applicator that you're comfortable with, you can use. I love this because it's like a sponge rolling pin and it makes it super easy to use. The most important thing I'm going to tell you about this is make sure you ink it all the way around. Oftentimes I see this, that's not going to help you because you're only getting ink right here. Make sure you press into your ink pad because this one's sponge and you're going to roll it all the way around so that it's circling the ink pad. Now we've got this lined up. I want to look and see if I got this going in the right direction. Okay, we're good. I'm going to start here off the paper and I'm going to roll off the paper. And I'm making sure that I'm going all the way across. And you might be thinking, oh, there's lines. Yeah, there's lines right now. Okay. And we're going to do this several times. So I'm going to ink this up again. I'm loading that sponge brayer with color and I'm coming across the bottom and then I'm going to work across the top. Now I know my fingers are here and I'm not really worried about getting all the way up there. So I'm going to load up more color, and how much or how little you do is a matter of personal preference. I always say it's not wrong if it's yours. So keep that in mind. It doesn't have to look exactly like mine or your Stampin' Friends. It's got to look just like the way you want it to look. So I'm going to repeat this process a couple times to get the density of the color that I'm looking for. And right here, where I'm going from light to dark, I am looking to blend these the best that I can. Now, do you see here where it's white? I'm going to turn that to make that easy for my hand. And now that the shade has been greatly reduced because I've been using it, I'm going to come up here and add just a really light tone to this. Do you see what this has done? Look at this ombre effect. Is this not gorgeous? Oh, so pretty. Now, you can go over this again, like I said, as much as you want. Just make sure that you gravitate the color so that the darkest is at the bottom. All right, I think you get the idea. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to close this up because an open ink pad around here is just a recipe for disaster. Anybody else with me? And then the next step is really, really important because what has happened now is the ink has actually laid on top of that embossed area. So it's kind of sticking to that. We need to buff this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a small piece of white paper towel, or in your case, it could be a white napkin. You want something that doesn't have any dye print on it. And then what you're going to do is you're going to buff this. It's actually going to bring a little bit of shine to it, and it's going to remove the ink that's laying on top of the white embossing. So that you see here, isn't that amazing? You don't even really see it. All right, so we've got my darkest here and then my lightest here, and I'm just making sure I've got the whole thing covered. All right, that looks pretty good. There's really no right or wrong way that this can go, in my opinion. It's just a matter of preference. If you want your darker at the bottom, go ahead and flip it, or at the top. I'm going to go ahead and set this aside for just a moment, and then I'm going to bring in a piece of thick whisper white cardstock. Now I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to move this, just to make it a little bit less distracting for you. I know that sometimes that color background can be a bit much. And I'm going to be using an image to kind of complement this background. Now I want to give you a little tip about this. Right now, you can just add it to a card base and a large greeting and you are done. If you like embellishments, you can add some as well. You do not have to go any further if you don't want to. But you know what? You know me, if you've watched my videos, I love to add some embellishments. And this time I'm going to add some stamped images as well as some embellishments because I want to give you more tips while you're with me. I'm going to be using this beautiful cake floral image, which I thought went great with that background stamp. And let me show it to you. It's called Happy Birthday to You. Now you're not going to find it in either the annual or the mini catalog, okay? It's not going to be in this one or this one I just shared with you. It is going to be in this one. This is Stampin' Up's largest sale of the year right now, and this is one of the free selections that are in here. Yes, I said free. So with any $50 product purchase of your choice, you can choose a free product from that sale brochure, and I chose this one. And I'm loving the words that you can build on top of each other. A little splatter here for some techniques, but I'm using this large image here. And since I'm going to be actually coloring this in, I'm going to be using a dye-based or water-based ink pad because I'm going to be using alcohol-based markers. Now, typically, I like to use the black Memento ink, but this card is so pretty and so subtle when I'm going to be done that I decided that was too harsh. So I'm going to try Smoky Slate. You can also try basic gray. Those are great options for you if you don't want that hard black tone. So I'm going to go ahead and open this up, and you're going to see this is very closely related in size. It will fit. So another tip for you is you can always turn your stamp face up on your work surface and ink it this way, especially if your stamp is large and you have a hard time maneuvering it. Or if sometimes you're like me and you get a little excited about inking it and you have a tendency of getting ink around those die cut edges of the image, which means you're going to have that shadow effect when you rock it. So just make sure that you ink it up. And of course it will fit this way if you travel a little bit. So either way works. And then I'm going to stamp that right here. Now remember, this is a piece of scrap. So lots of firm, even pressure. You want to make sure that you get the details out. Another thing I hear often is, how come my images don't come out crisp and clean like yours? Take your time. That's a really, really important tip. Oftentimes people want to go too quickly. And then what happens is, especially with these detailed stamps, they don't get that beautiful, clean image. Take your time. Now, I know that I've shared lots of coloring in videos before. So today what I want to focus on is a cool trick that I want to teach you using the Stampin' Blends markers. I've got one that's completely finished, so I'm not coloring in this whole thing, but I want to talk you through one flower on my finished card that's going to be here. I chose two different sets of Stampin' Blends markers, Highland Heather and Purple Posy. Now you can see that they're very closely related in color, but there's a hue variation. Well, I didn't want all my flowers to look exactly the same purple because there's only two shades here. So I started to do some experimenting and I was super excited with the results, which is what I want to share with you right now. Let's take the two lightest shades of those colors and move them aside. And I'm going to tell you right now that you can use this technique that I'm going to teach you with any two coordinating color families, whether it's blues, purples, yellows, greens, it doesn't matter. It's going to work. But what it's going to do is it's going to allow you maybe just to purchase a few if you're getting started to mix and match to get a third variation or a third hue. All right, so what I'm going to do first is I'm going to choose the lightest of these two dark shades. In this case, it's going to be the Purple Posy. And just to kind of speed things up, I'm going to use the thicker tip of this marker. This is the thinner one. Let me open that up. And then I'm going to color in just a few petals. Now, the biggest thing I can tell you about the Stampin' Blends markers is, first of all, how much I really, really love them because they are flawless. Unlike a dye-based marker, which will leave lines or streaking behind if you repeat an area, alcohol-based Stampin' Blends markers will not. Also, they're very forgiving. Don't think you've got to color in every single little area. You don't. Any white areas just lead credence to highlighting. All right, so now what we're going to do is we're going to switch over to the darker shade. And this is the Highland Heather Dark. And you see these little small sketch lines here inside the image? Well, the concept artist who designed this stamp actually put them there for definition. But I love them as cheat marks. And I talk about this all the time because I am no artist by any shape or sense of the word. But I love to color because it's really therapeutic. So I just use those to help me get an idea of where I'm going to add some color. Now, I know that this color is really, really dark and it doesn't coordinate and it doesn't really match the Purple Posy. So I'm like, well, I just want to kind of add a little color and I wonder if this is going to work. And I was pleasantly surprised. Now, very, very important. This has to sit and process for a few seconds because the second layer of alcohol ink needs to evaporate. If you go back over now with the other color to try to blend these harsh lines together, you're going to get one hot mess of bleeding. So be a little bit patient. What I love about this is because obviously you can go in and you can color the other areas of your stamp while you're waiting. Now, while I'm talking you through that, I want to talk to you about what I did. I have another sample to share with you tonight that is almost identical with the exception of one thing on the card we're making tonight, and that is here in the center. Have you ever made a card and then gone and made it a second time and changed it up just a little bit and thought, why didn't I think of that the first time? That's exactly what happened to me. I decided to bring in a little bit of yellow here, which I didn't do on the first one. Now, this is Daffodil Delight, and I'm starting with the light, and I'm going to add that here. Now, this is that chisel tip, which is great for those small areas. And then I'm going to take the dark one and I'm going to add a little definition at the bottom. Now, in these tiny little areas, you don't have to worry about going back and blending them because there's not much area to blend. So don't worry about that. We're going to go back now to that dark Purple Posy, which is the lightest color on the bottom. And we're going to start blending this. Now, I'm going to move you in even closer if I can. Let's see if we can get you closer. Yep, there we go. And I'm going to walk you through this. The worst thing you can do is scribble the whole thing. Start where there's a dark area and pull the color out. Do you see how it looks wet? That's because it is. That alcohol has to start to evaporate to process. So you could start moving these colors out. I absolutely love the mixing and matching that you can provide with these markers so that you can get an additional tone. Now, this one obviously is going to need a little bit more time to process, but because of the magic of live, we have this one. Look at this. Oh my gosh, is this pretty or what? All right, so let me talk you through the rest of the colors that are here because I know that you're probably going to ask. This is the mix and matched one that we just did. So that's dark Highland Heather and dark purple Posy. This one is the Highland Heather. This one is the purple Posy. So these are their individual light and darks, and this is the mix. And then I added yellow centers. My leaves are actually using the dark and light mint macaron. And then the bottom of my cake stand is the smoky slate. Isn't this pretty? Now, I got another confession. I actually did this old school with my scissors. You know what? I love to fussy cut. It doesn't bother me. But oh, am I excited to tell you that there are coordinating dies to this stamp set that you can buy starting February 4th. Not only are there dies for this beautiful Happy Birthday to You stamp set that we're using tonight, but there are coordinating dies for lots of the other sale items that are available. So these will be for sale. I wanted to share that with you so that you don't look at this and think, eek, I'm not going to cut that. You don't have to. All right, let's move you out a little bit further and let's do some assembly. So I'm going to take this and I'm going to work on a piece of Whisper White cardstock. This is 4 1/4 by 11. I scored it right before you joined me and I'm a big fan of that bone folder for that nice crisp edge on my card. I'm going to add that brayered background to this and I'm going to add some adhesive to the backside. This is my silicone craft sheet. I cannot live without this in my stamp studio. Adhesive, liquid glue, and hot glue will not stick to it, which means if you get close to the edges, which I often do, and it ends up on your work table, you're not going to be fighting a sticky spot the whole time that you're crafting. Now, this is a lot more generous than I typically am, simply because I know it's been heat embossed and it's inked, and I'm really cognizant of the fact that I want this to stick well. Now, I purposely cut this so that I would have a small margin of white here and here. I don't know about you, but I have a hard time doing things vertically. So here's another tip. Turn your paper sideways. I'm going to leave my darkest portion at the bottom. I'm going to get my head down here and do my very best not to be in your camera view. And I am going to align the sides, leaving a little margin at the top and the bottom, and we'll press that in place. Now, I like to rub from the back because it never fails when I'm paper crafting. Do you do this? You get ink on your hand, and then you transfer it to the front of your project. Okay. Remember this. Well, as beautiful as this is, and as beautiful as this is, I thought, well, that's not going to be a good separation of color. So what I did is I pulled out a piece of vellum and one of my very favorite die sets, my layering circles dies. There are scallops in graduating sizes, as well as regular circles and sizes and graduating sizes. So you can layer these up together. Love, love, love these. So we've got circles, ovals, squares, stitched, all kinds of fun things. So I die cut myself one of the scalloped ones because I thought if I could break this up just a little bit by giving this area right behind here a little bit of an opaque finish that will allow this to be really predominant on the front of the card and not take away from the background at the same time. So what I decided to do was I'm going to add adhesive to the back of this to adhere it to here. And I'm going to give you another tip about using the vellum. So I'm going to flip this over. Now, I know this cake is going to be a little bit too tall, so I'm not going to go all the way to the top. I'm going to add adhesive here and just a tiny bit there. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my vellum and I'm going to put my cake right on top of here. I'm just going to center it the best that I can. Now, if you're like me and you got a little excited and your adhesive is sticky here and you didn't want it, I want to give you another tip. Remember that embossing buddy that we used to prepare the surface for heat embossing? Guess what? It takes off sticky. All you have to do is tap it right on the sticky area and it's gone. This is great if you've made an oops too and you need to rip off dimensionals or adhesive and you're able to salvage the piece you worked on. Use that embossing buddy. All right, so the next step for me is to add dimensionals to the back side. So I've got my full size dimensionals here and I'm going to be generous with these because I want to make sure that it's going to hold my whole thing in place. Here's the vellum tip. You don't want to put any adhesives here because it's going to show. So you're going to use the backside of this as a gauge on where you're going to place these. Now, I'm doing this in a cascade fashion here for a reason, and I'll show you in just a minute. And then I'm going to add another here and another here. That's pretty good. You see down here, those dimensionals are a little bit too big for that. So I love these mini dimensionals. This take your pick tool is like my favorite thing. It's got interchangeable tips, and I use this little tip here to pick up those small dimensionals. And I love this to help me remove those paper backings. It corrals them as well, and you can pull them up, and I love that. Look at that, all in one little pile, ready for the trash. All right, this now is ready for my embellishment. And this time I decided to do something really, really different. Now you might be looking at this thinking, what is that? Well, this used to be an entire 18-inch piece of white flax ribbon. But do you see how the center is missing? That's because, did you know that you can take and you can pull out several strands at a time, which is going to allow you to work with this like you would baker's twine or linen thread. The reason I like this better is it's a little bit thicker and I find it's a little bit easier to use. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this and I'm going to fold it in half. And if it's not even on the ends, all the better. And then fold it in half one more time. So now we've ended up with this loop. Remember these dimensionals right here? This is where I'm going to lay this. This has to be prepped and ready to go so that they can stick to this. Now, this might not look really great from the front, but we're going to foo-foo this out in just a minute. Once we kind of get this tacked down, there we go, and we can separate that. You can use metallic threads. You can skip this if you don't even like it. But I loved the separation that gave this, especially when we're getting ready to put it here. Make sure that you work within the circumference of your card. That's very, very important that you got to get this in and out of the envelope. And then we're going to tack this here. Look at those yellow centers. Aren't those really just popping on here? And then you can fan those out however you'd like. Now, I did stamp the greeting ahead of time because at my age, I knew I wasn't going to get this on here while you were all watching without having my head in the camera. So I'm going to attach this, but there's going to be an elevation difference here. Do you see this? Because this is higher than this. So I want to give you another tip. Here on the back of the word celebrate, where the C is, I'm going to add a little bit of adhesive. And then on the rest of this, I'm going to add a couple dimensionals. So I got one, two, that's one more than I need. And then I'm going to remove those paper backings. This is going to allow me to make sure that the area that's raised here is going to be with the adhesive. And the area that's not raised is going to fall with the dimensionals. And I brought this all the way over to the edge of my card. Okay, one more step because I loved it. And again, you can stop at any point if this is where you're happy. I love this product, and you can see I've got quite a few missing. These are the frosted and clear epoxy droplets. So you're going to see that they're slightly domed. They don't increase the mailing, but I love the look. Unlike rhinestones, they are not faceted. So I chose the frosted because I thought those looked really pretty with the vellum. They already have glue dots on the back. So let me take off those paper backings there. And I'm going to pick one up here and I'm going to put a large one up here. Wait till you see how all this comes together. It's so pretty, isn't it? I would love to know what color you would do this embossed ombre resist background. That's what this is called, an ombre resist background. You're going to do this actually over an embossed background. Isn't that pretty? Now, you might remember that I told you I had my original one, for which I'm going to put a link down in the video description below. And I'm going to give you the cutting dimensions for this too. It just give Megan and I a few minutes after tonight's live, and we'll come back down right below this video. You might have to click show more to expand the text. And there'll be a link there that will lead you over to all the pictures, the cutting dimensions and supplies for this project. Here is the one I originally made, no yellow centers. And then I thought, well, why did I color those purple? Like I said, sometimes you make the same card twice and then you vastly change it when you go to make it a second time. Now, I want to share something else with you about this stamp set that I think you're going to enjoy. Every month, I do what's called a Live with Lisa event. Let me turn the camera around. It's a reward for my customers who place a $25 product order using the host code. They're invited to a private YouTube event where I do several demonstrations like this, but bigger. I give them a huge bundle of tutorials, 8 to be exact. In addition to that, I do product prize giveaways, and that is only in exchange for a $25 product order. It's lots of fun, super casual, and the tutorials that I share with them are then sold in my PDF library, like dirt cheap, $5, $6. As a matter of fact, I've got 4 other project ideas using the Happy Birthday to You stamp set that are going to be available this coming at the end of the week on Friday. But if you place a $25 product order in my online store, you're going to get those tutorials for free during Live with Lisa. Here's a quick look at it. It is 10 pages long. It will be sold for $6 towards the end of the week, but I would absolutely love to reward you for this fun, exclusive event. I don't duplicate those demonstrations elsewhere, nor those projects, so it's lots and lots of fun. Now, if you have enjoyed tonight's video, do me a favor and give it a thumbs up here on YouTube. It certainly helps. I'm reaching over for these beautiful catalogs. If you don't already have a Stampin' Up! Demonstrator and you would like to receive your own complimentary copies, head over to lisasstampstudio.com and click on Contact Me. I'll be happy to send you one. Of course, I'll throw in that sale brochure because I always say if it's free, it's for me. If you have enjoyed tonight's video, too, share it with your crafting friends. Your referral is the highest compliment that you can do for me. And subscribe because you're not going to want to miss. I'm going to be back with you on Monday, February 3rd, for a brand new project. And I sure hope that you'll be here to join me. Megan, thanks for all your hard work tonight, and I'm so glad that you've joined me. I look forward to seeing you next time. Have a great evening.